Today I am going to give you a lecture on vector spaces. Vector spaces, in order to define a definition of vector space, first of all we discuss the field, which is F plus dot, where F is any non-empty set having a two binary operation, addition and multiplication. In addition to these two binary operations, F possesses three important properties. F consists of an abelian group for additive operation. F again consists of an abelian group for multiplicative operation. And the third important property is distributive law. This distributive law holds in field. So any non-empty set F having a two binary operation, addition and multiplication, and which form an abelian group for addition, abelian group for multiplicative operation, and it possesses the distributive laws, right and left, both right and left distributive laws. See, for vector space, we require a field, because if V is any non-empty set, which is equipped with the two binary operation, vector addition and scalar multiplication. So the elements of V are usually known as vector. Suppose you draw a figure for vector space. Elements of V are usually denoted by alpha, beta and gamma. These are the vector elements of V. And elements of F are scalars, which is usually denoted by A, B and C. Then the set V is called a vector space over the field F if it satisfies the following three properties. Any non-empty set V having these three properties is known as vector space. The very first property is V form an abelian group for additive operation. This shows for abelian group we require five important properties. The very first is a closure property. If we choose two alpha and beta arbitrary vectors in V, then definitely their sum alpha plus beta is again a member of V. And due to this property, V is closed for vector additions. The second important property is associative property. Let us consider alpha, beta and gamma are three vectors, arbitrary vectors of V. Then they must satisfy this criteria of associative property, means alpha plus beta plus gamma is equal to alpha plus beta plus gamma. The third property is identity. For every vector alpha which belongs to V, there exists a particular zero vector in V, such that alpha plus zero vector or a zero vector plus alpha is again an alpha. And the next property is inverse property. For every vector alpha which belongs to V, there exists a unique inverse element which is minus alpha in V. So alpha is inverse element of minus alpha, and vice versa, minus alpha is again inverse of alpha. And the fifth property, which is a commutative property for additive operation, means for any two vectors alpha and beta which belongs to V, we must have alpha plus beta is equal to beta plus alpha. This is the commutative property. And with these five properties, the help of these five properties, this V construct an abelian group for additive operation. And the second property for vector space is V must be closed for a scalar multiplication. Means if we choose any scalar which belongs to F, for example A, and some vector alpha which belongs to V. Here alpha and A both are arbitrary elements belongs to V and F. Then there's some, then the product A alpha is again a member of V. Means A alpha is a vector quantity, because you multiply a scalar to the vector. So the resulting vector A alpha is again a member of V. So V is closed for scalar multiplication. For every alpha which belongs to V, for every A belongs to F, which is a scalar quantity, the resulting vector, that is A into alpha, is again a member of V. And the third important property is, for any two vector alpha beta, which is member of our non-empty set V, and for any two scalars, which is arbitrarily chosen from F, A dot alpha plus beta is equal to A alpha plus A beta. This property is usually known as linearity property. So A alpha plus A beta. And if we operate A plus B over A alpha, then it becomes A alpha plus B alpha. Next property is A times of alpha beta is equal to A times of alpha into beta. And for every alpha which belongs to B, there exists a scalar 1 in F. So such that 1 dot alpha always produces alpha. So any non-empty set V which possesses these three properties. The first is V must form an abelian group for additive operation. And the second property is V must be closed for scalar multiplication. And the third property is these four properties falls in V. Then V construct a vector space. Now we come to the definition of vector surface space. For vector space VF, having a field F, any non-empty subset W which contains V, if itself form a vector space, then W is known as subspace of vector space V. And W is also closed for the same operation, vector addition and scalar multiplication. Means any non-empty subset of vector space form a vector space under the induced operation is known as vector subspace. Next definition is linear combination. Suppose V is a vector space having a field F. Let us consider n vectors alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha n which belongs to vector space V. For each vector we consider a scalar like A1, A2, A3, An which belongs to field F. Then alpha is said to be a linear combination of n vectors. If it can be expressed as alpha is equal to A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 and so on up to An alpha n. So this alpha is known as LC, linear combination of n vectors belongs to V. Now we come to the definition of linear span. Let us consider a vector space VF over a field F. Any non-empty subset S, any non-empty subset S of V, then the linear span of S is the set of all linear combinations of finite sets of elements of S, and it is usually denoted by capital L of S. And thus we have linear span of set S is given by alpha, beta, gamma, where individually alpha itself a linear combination of finite number of vectors alpha 1 to alpha n which belongs to S. Beta is another linear combination which consists of m vectors beta 1, beta 2, beta m which belongs to again S. And gamma is another linear combination which is a linear combination of gamma 1, gamma 2 up to gamma l, l number of vectors which belongs to S. So these are the linear combinations. So LS is basically collection of all linear combinations of finite elements of S. Now linearly dependent, let V of P a vector space, a finite set of vectors of V is said to be a linearly dependent if there exists scalars, not all of them zero, some of them may be zero, such that A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 plus A3 alpha 3 up to An alpha n is equal to zero, where alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n are n vectors belongs to B and A1, A2, A3, An belongs to F, which are scalars. So any set of vectors is said to be an LD if not all scalars are zero, some of them may be zero, but at least one scalar must be a non-zero scalar. And if it satisfies this condition, then such set of vectors are known as linearly dependent. Now, linearly independent, let V of P a vector space, a finite set of vectors of V is said to be a linearly independent if every relation of this particular form A1 alpha 1, A2 alpha 2, A3 alpha 3 up to An alpha n, where A1, A2, AN scalars belongs to field F, and alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha n belongs to V, vector space V, such that if this linear combination is equal to 0, conclude that all scalars, means AI is equal to 0 for each I greater than equal to 1, less than equal to n. This implies all scalars A1, A2, A3 are individually 0. If all scalars are 0, then the set of vectors alpha 1 to alpha n, which belongs to a vector space V, is known as linearly independent. So there is a slight difference between a linearly dependent and linearly independent. In case of linearly independent, all scalars are individually 0, while in case of linearly dependent, few scalars are non-zero. Now we define a basis. For a vector space Vf over the field F, we consider a subset of V, which is S. S is any non-empty subset of V. This S is said to be a basis for vector space Vf if S satisfies two criteria. The very first criteria is S is linearly independent. And the second one is S must generate V. S generates V means if every vector of V can be expressed as a linear combination of finite elements of set S. So any non-empty set for a vector space is known as basis for the vector space if S is a linearly independent set, means all scalars are individually 0. And secondly, S must generate V, that is L is equal to V. And this implies each vector of vector space V can be expressed as a linear combination of elements of S. Mathematically, basis is basically S must be a linearly independent, that is A1, alpha 1, A2, alpha 2, up to N alpha n equal to 0. And according to the LI definition, all scalars must be 0. And where alpha 1 to alpha n are members of set S, A1 to AN are scalars which belongs to field. And the second, this S must generate V, that is LS equal to V. And every vector, let us consider any vector alpha which belongs to a vector space V. It can be expressed as a linear combination of finite elements of S, which is alpha 1 to alpha n. So this alpha is equal to A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 up to AN alpha n. So for every alpha which belongs to V, we have this linear combination of finite vectors of S and finite scalars from field. Such subset of vector space V is called a basis. Now we define a linear sum of two subspaces. Let us consider a vector space Vf over the field F having a two subspaces, namely W1 and W2. So this Vf is a vector space having a field F and two subspaces, namely W1 and W2. Then the linear sum of these two subspaces is defined as W1 plus W2. This is the linear sum of two subspaces W1 and W2, and it consists of elements like alpha 1 plus alpha 2. This is just single element for W1 plus W2, which consists of by sum of two elements, where first element belongs to W1, while the second element, which is alpha 2, is a member of W2. So, and usually we denote linear sum of two subspaces by ordinary addition symbol, this plus symbol. Now we discuss few theorems. Just we go through the statement of few important theorems, like the very first algebra of subspaces. The intersection of any two subspaces W1 and W2 of a vector space Vf is again a subspace of Vf. If we consider a vector space Vf over the field F and two subspaces W1 and W2. And their intersection is not phi because at least zero vector belongs to both W1 as well as W2. Because according to the definition of subspaces, subspaces are non-empty subset of vector space which itself form a vector space for the induced operation. So W1 must contain an identity, zero vector. So zero vector belongs to W1, and the zero vector is again a member of W2, because W2 itself is some space, and there exists a one element which is common to both. So W1 intersection W2 is not phi, it contains only single element which is 0 bar. So the intersection of any two subspaces, W1 and W2 of a vector space, is also a subspace. So from here we conclude that W1 intersection W2 is also form a, W1 intersection W2 also form a subspace of VF. While the union of any two subspaces is a subspace if and only if one is contained in another. Means, if we consider a vector space V here over the field F, and suppose we have one subspace as W1, the other one is W2, and this W2 is entirely contained in W1. In this particular case, their union also form a subspace of V. But in this case, the union of W1 and W2 does not form a subspace, because the criteria is one must contain in the other one. So this is not the case of W1 containing W2 or W2 containing W1, but this is the case where W2 containing W1. So in all such cases, when one subspace containing the another subspace, then only their union form a subspace. The next theorem is the necessary and sufficient condition for a non-empty subset W of a vector space V have to be a subspace of V if it is closed for with respect to vector addition and scalar multiplication. So this is the necessary and sufficient condition for any non-empty subset which is closed for vector addition and scalar multiplication. The next theorem is the necessary and sufficient condition for a non-empty subset W of a vector space VF to be a subspace of VF. Let us consider a vector space VF over the field F having a subspace W. And W is a subspace of vector space VF over the same field F. If we choose any two arbitrary elements, alpha and beta, which belongs to W. Any two arbitrarily chosen element alpha and beta which belongs to W, and any two scalars A and B which belongs to field F. So A and B are scalars because they belong to F, and alpha and beta are vectors, which is vectors which belongs to W, and W is a subset of V. If this implies A alpha plus B beta, means the linear combination of these two scalars with the vector alpha and beta, A alpha plus B beta. If this resulting element A alpha plus B beta is again a member of W, then only W form a subspace of V. So this is the necessary and sufficient condition for any non-empty subset to be a subspace of V. If this criteria fulfills, definitely your W form a subspace, and if W is a subspace, then this criteria always holds. The next theorem is the necessary and sufficient condition for a non-empty subset W of a vector space VF to be a subspace is slightly different from the previous theorem, because here instead of A and B we have just one scalar A. Because if you choose B is equal to 1, 1 being a scalar quantity, if you replace B with 1 in the theorem 1, this theorem 2 deduced from the theorem 1, if you replace B is equal to 1. So for every two arbitrary element alpha beta which belongs to W, and for every A scalar belongs to F, A alpha plus beta is a member of W. So this is another condition when your subset becomes a subspace. And the next theorem is the linear span LS. And we know that this LS consists of all the linear combinations which consist of finite set of vectors of S. This LS, linear span LS, of any subset S of a vector space VF is also a subspace. This is universal for any linear span of any non-empty subset S of a vector space, that LS always form a subspace of V. Now we discuss direct sum of subspace. See, this direct sum is slightly different from our ordinary linear sum. In case of linear sum, we have one element from one subspace and the other element from another subspace, and we simply add them. Like, suppose we have some alpha 1 element which belongs to W1 and some another alpha 2 element belongs to W2. Then we describe our linear sum as W1 plus W2. And this W1 plus W2 is called a linear sum of two subspaces having an element like alpha 1 plus alpha 2, which is just ordinary sum of two vectors, one vector alpha 1 from first vector subspace and alpha 2 from the subspace W2. But in case of direct sum, we have one additional property. Every direct sum itself a linear sum with some specific property of uniqueness. Means if we have a vector space and suppose we have m number of subspaces are there, like W1, W2, W3 up to Wm are m subspaces of V, then V is said to be a direct sum of these subspaces if every vector which belongs to V can be uniquely expressible as a member of these subspaces. For example, we consider if a vector space Vf is a direct sum of two subspaces. For example, suppose we have two subspaces W1 and W2. If a vector space Vf is a direct sum of these two subspaces W1 and W2, then we should not have only V is equal to W1 plus W2. Means it's not a just linear sum of two subspaces, but also each vector of V can be uniquely expressed as a sum of an element of W1 and sum of an element of W2. So symbolically, in case of direct sum, we use this particular symbol. Means the plus sign encircled is the notation for a direct sum. Usually W1 plus W2 is read as a linear sum of two subspaces, while W1 plus encircle W2 is the notation for direct sum. So in case of direct sum, we have elements like alpha 1 plus alpha 2. But this sum alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is a unique. It can be expressed in one and only one way. So this uniqueness gives us a direct sum of subspaces. For linear sum, we have just ordinary sum. Next theorem is, if we have two subspaces W1 and W2 of a vector space Vf, then their linear sum W1 plus W2 is always form a subspace for vector space Vf. And the linear span of union of two subspaces W1 and W2 is equal to a linear sum of two subspaces. Now, this is a very important theorem. According to this existence theorem, every finitely generated or finite dimensional vector space always possesses at least one basis. There exists a basis for each finite dimensional vector space. So, if we have a finitely generated vector space or a finite dimensional vector space, then definitely there exists a basis. At least one basis must be there. And this invariance theorem, according to the invariance theorem, this theorem sometimes known as dimension theorem also. And if Vf is a finite dimensional vector space, then any two bases of vector space V having the same number of elements means the number of elements remains invariant. So this theorem is known as invariance theorem. Let us consider a vector space Vf over the field F. And suppose we have two bases of this vector space Vf, S1 and S2. If S1 and S2 are two bases of vector space Vf, and where Vf is finitely generated vector space, then this S1 and S2 must possess a similar number of elements. If we count the number of elements in S1 and S2, both are identical. Then this is true for any two bases of vector space Vf, not just for particular two bases S1 and S2, it is true for any two bases. Then that's why it is defined as that any two bases of V have the same number of elements. The next theorem is extension theorem. See, according to this extension theorem, every linearly independent subset of a finite generated vector space Vf form a part of basis. Part of basis means either it form a basis or it can be extended to form a basis of V. If you consider a vector space, suppose we consider a vector space Vf over the field F, and any linearly independent, let us consider a set subset S of vector space Vf. This S is a linearly, every linearly independent subset of a finitely generated vector space Vf form a part of basis of V. If S is linearly independent, let us consider a set, subset S of V which is Li set, means linearly independent. Means if we consider a linear combination A1 alpha 1 plus A2 alpha 2 up to An alpha n is equal to 0, and this conclude that every scalar is individually 0, because every linearly independent subset of finitely generated vector space Vf form a part of basis. So either S itself a basis or it can be extended to form a basis. That's why it is written a part of a basis. The next theorem is each set of n plus 1 or more vectors of finite dimensional vector space Vf of dimension n is linearly dependent. If the dimension of vector space is already known, suppose we consider a vector space Vf having a dimension n, and this vector space Vf with dimension n having a subset S which consists of n plus 1 or more vectors, means the number of vectors in S exceed the dimension of our vector space. In such cases, S is always LD, linearly dependent. The next theorem, if Vf is a finite dimensional vector space of dimension n, then any set of n linearly independent vectors in V form a basis for V. Let us consider a vector space Vf over the field F. See, according to the definition of basis, any non-empty subset of vector space V, let us consider a non-empty subset as S. This S form a basis for V if S fulfills the two criteria. S must be linearly independent, and secondly, S must generate the vector space V. Then only S become a basis for vector space V. According to this theorem, if Vf is a finite dimensional vector space of dimension n, then any set of n linearly independent vector in V form a basis of V. And the second theorem is, if a set S of n vectors of finite dimensional vector space Vf of dimension n generates Vf, then S is the basis of V. So what is dimension of vector space? The number of element is the basis of vector space, decide the dimension in the vector space. Suppose we have vector space Vf having a basis S with three elements. If S consists of three elements, then this shows the dimension of our vector space is 3. Next theorem is, each subspace W of a finite dimensional vector space Vf of dimension n is a finite dimensional subspace with dimension W is less than or equal to n. This shows dimension of subspace is always less than or equal to dimension of vector space, particularly when subspace is identical with the vector space. At that time, V is equal to W. This implies if and only if dimension V is equal to dimension of W. The second theorem is, if W1 and W2 are two subspaces of a finite dimensional vector space Vf, then dimension of linear sum of two subspaces is equal to dimension of first subspace plus dimension of second subspace minus dimension of their intersection, because intersection of two subspaces is again another subspace, and being a subvector space, they always possess a dimension. Now we describe a quotient subspace. If W is any non-empty subset of a vector space Vf, then we describe a set which is V by W, which is known as a quotient set, having a elements like cosets, where alpha belongs to V and W is a subspace of V. Then W plus alpha and W plus beta, these are the two right cosets of W in V, and their addition is defined as, if we add these two cosets, W plus alpha plus W plus beta, the resulting coset will be W plus alpha plus beta. Because W plus W become a W, because W is a subspace, so is always closed for vector addition. And the second scalar multiplication is defined A dot alpha, W plus alpha is equal to W plus A alpha, where A belongs to F, which is a scalar, and alpha belongs to V. For this type of two, vector addition and scalar multiplication, this V by W quotient set always form a vector space, and this vector space is known as a quotient space. Next theorem, if W be a subspace of finite dimensional vector space Vf, then dimension of quotient space V by W is given as difference of dimension V minus dimension W. Means if we subtract the dimension of subspace from the dimension of vector space, we get dimension of V by W, which is our quotient space. The next term is the necessary and sufficient condition for a vector space Vf to be a direct sum of two subspaces W1 and W2 are that first V must be a linear sum of these two subspaces W1 and W2. And the second condition, W1 and W2 must be a disjoint subspaces. For disjoint subspaces, there exists only one element which is common to both the subspaces, and that is zero, a zero subspace. Now, if a finite dimensional vector space Vf is a direct sum of two subspaces W1 and W2, in such cases, the dimension of vector space V is exactly equal to dimension of W1 plus dimension of W2. This happens only in the case of direct sum. Now we describe the cosets for a subspace. Let us consider W be any subspace of a vector space Vf, and alpha be any element of V, then the right coset of subspace W is W plus alpha, which consists of elements like gamma plus alpha, where gamma is any arbitrary element which belongs to W. And because we multiply this alpha element, arbitrary element of P from right hand side, so this W plus alpha is usually known as right coset of subspace W in V. And similarly, we define our left cosets, A alpha plus W, which consists of element like alpha plus gamma, where gamma belongs to W, is called a left coset of W in V generated by alpha. And these are the few important results. Like if we consider a zero vector in vector space V, then this implies a right coset of subspace W with zero vector, like W plus zero vector is equal to W. Alpha is some arbitrary element of W, then this implies W plus alpha is equal to W, because W being a member of alpha being a member of W, and W itself form a subspace, being a subspace it form a vector space, and it is always closed for a vector addition. So W plus alpha always coincide with W. If you consider the two right cosets are identical, like W plus alpha is equal to W plus beta, which are two right cosets of W and V. If two right cosets W plus alpha and W plus beta are same, this implies alpha minus beta belongs to W. This condition is vice versa. If alpha plus W plus alpha and W plus beta are identical, then alpha minus beta belongs to W. And if alpha minus beta belongs to W, then this implies both the right cosets are identical. Okay. Now we come to the next definition, which is disjoint subspaces. Let us consider two subspaces W1 and W2 of the vector space Vf are disjoint if their intersection having only zero element, means W1 intersection W2 consists of alone identity zero vector element. Thank you.